All right, good afternoon. We having a good Talent Connect, everybody? Yeah, I can see smiley faces in the room, that's great. So my name's Alex Cresswell. I run the Global Accounts organization for LinkedIn here in EMEA. So it's my team that works with the Shell team that you're going to be hearing from in just a moment. And I was asked to open up this session, which I was absolutely delighted to do, because this is a topic that I find just really, really exciting. This idea that when you can get a congruency between what it's like to work inside your organization and then what you're saying to the outside world about what it's like to work in your organization, when you can get this authentic voice from your employees really coming out into your EVP, then magical things start to happen. It's really cool. The employer brand starts to absolutely sing. And the payback that you then get in your ability to attract and retain top talent just is absolutely magnified. So this is a journey that the LinkedIn team has been on with the Shell team for the last 2 or 3 years. And what you're going to hear about this afternoon is about the transformation that the Shell team has been on. They've been transforming the talent acquisition function, and they've also been transforming the way in which they're putting forward their employer brand out there into the market. And they're leveraging their employees and the innovation and inspiration that's inside their company and just putting it out there into the marketplace. One of the byproducts that comes from this when you do it really, really well is that you start to get recognized by the market for what you're doing. And one of the ways that Shell are getting recognized is through our global InDemand rankings. They've consistently been a top performer in the InDemand rankings. You can see that they're at number 12. These are the global InDemand rankings, in case you haven't seen them. They're at 12 right now. They're the top oil and gas company. And this is as a result of the wonderful things that they've been doing. So you haven't come here to listen to me. Let's get on with it. And I'll, without further ado, I will hand over to Ed from Shell, who will kick things off.
Yes, thanks very much, Alex. I'm very proud to be here. As Alex mentioned, we've been on kind of this journey and transformation for about 3 years. And I'm happy to say that most of it is already implemented now. So I'm a bit more relaxed now than I was a couple of years back. But before I start telling you about our journey, how many of you have actually been in the session with Lou Adler before? Ah, quite a few hands here. So, I mean, that's a really inspiring story. And I think if you really take recruitment as a real profession in your organization, I would say these are really the tips and the tricks that you need to do as an organization. And what we will try to do is show you a little bit of what Shell has done in order to get in that place. Yeah, so bear with me. Let's see if the clicker actually works. So, game-changing strategies to becoming an employer of choice. So you've seen the in-demand rankings, but it goes much wider than that. That's definitely not just the LinkedIn rankings. We also go to universities and other rankings that we want to be perceived as the employer of choice. And that's a journey that we went on with Shell. So before I really get into the nitty-gritty, I have a slide, so here's the compliance in Shell, that I give you about 10 minutes to read through. No, I'm just kidding. But basically it says everything I'm saying on my own account, will not influence any of the stock or the share price of Shell, which I'm sure it wouldn't. So just having said that. So our presentation today, it's myself. So I'm the Global Operations Manager for Recruitment. Together with my colleague Anna Alonso, who heads up our marketing division, who will talk a little bit later about the brand. So I want to share with you a little bit what an exciting time it is to work in the energy industry. Actually, maybe a lot of people don't know what it's like to work in the energy industry. And obviously, we don't have these cool features like Google and Apple, but we do have a lot of good story to tell to people. Then we'll go into the bit where it's really talking about the journey and what have we done to get us in the place where we are today, and share some of our learnings and successes along the way. So looking at the energy industry, I don't know how many of you are in the energy industry or related to the energy industry. Well, quite a few hands, very good. So this is like a real world scale challenge, right? So energy industry, like the food and energy, water and food, are real life challenges we have today. And of course, there's companies that have real nice gadgets, and you'll be thinking about what's the next app, or you'll be thinking about what's the next fragrance. But in an energy company, you're actually looking at the bigger problems of the world. And given the complexity of the globe at the moment, that is a very exciting place to work. Now, to put that a little bit into context, we have a few things to share with you. So at Shell, we're very much into scenario planning. Yeah? So our business is very much about the long term and how can we envision ourselves in 2050 in this case. And what do we need to do? And what do people expect from the world and of energy in 2050? Now, one of the things is that we have a growing population. It goes to 9 billion probably in 2050. That's 2 billion more than we have today. That's a reality. I mean, it's not something we made up. It's a reality. It will happen. And about 75% of those folks will live in cities. And that poses the question, how do you organize your cities? How do you supply energy to your cities? So these are the types of questions that we think about in Shell. Another thing is about the vehicles. So I get a lot of questions by friends that say, oh, these electric cars, that's really going to be, pretty soon we don't need oil anymore. Well, I would say we need electric cars to be able to fuel the 2 billion cars that we will have in 2050. Yeah. Because also they run on energy, and surprise, surprise, how do we get energy? It comes also from oil and gas. At the current situation, a lot of countries coming out of poverty needing more energy, which is basically doubling our energy demand in 2050. Yeah? So bear that in mind. That is huge complexity, huge challenges that we have ahead of us. Yeah. Now, there's some things about if we want to keep the same level of wealth that we have today, we need to do it with half of the energy that we spend today. So we need to be much more efficient with the energy that we use. And then finally, it's not just about the hydrocarbons, so the traditional types of energy and oil and gas. It's also about the renewable sources like biofuels, like wind, like solar, because given the picture that I've painted, we need all these resources to maintain our level of standard of living. So that was just painting the picture of the complexity. I think hopefully that is a little bit more than just what you know about Shell, about the retail stations. You think, oh, okay, well, they sell gas, but we do a lot more. So then looking a bit further, I'm thinking the clicker is working. So things people might not know about Shell. So obviously it's a big brand, global organization, active in 70 countries. But given the size of the organization, we actually don't have a lot of employees. We have about 92,000 employees. Now don't get me wrong, we have about 1 million people working for Shell on a daily basis, yeah? But they're not Shell employees. So we really see the Shell employees as our, let's call it the nerve system of the whole business that we are running. And that also already creates the importance of our employees that they are for the company. Hence that we spend a lot of money investment in people to develop them as well. So other facts about Shell that you might not know, that we're actually more of a gas company than an oil company nowadays. We produce more gas than oil. And even with all that production, we only have 2% of the world's oil production. So Shell, only 2%. And the same goes for gas. We have 3% of the whole gas production. So it's even within that space, it's a relatively small piece of the pie. Yeah? But what it's really about, and I told you about our employees, it's also really about innovation. I've talked about the challenges that we have ahead of us. We need the best and the brightest to be able to overcome these challenges. And a lot of that sits in innovation. Yeah? So, and I can talk about that we were in the top 10 of the most innovative companies, but that's not about that. It's about being innovative every day. And not just in our labs, but also in how we do recruitment. Yeah? So let me share a little bit about what that innovation looks like. So obviously we have lots of big projects. Yeah, so to get to oil, to get to gas, you need really big projects. So this is an example. And we have a floating LNG, an enormous ship that we're building. But to engineer that, to design that, to actually build it, it's an enormous amount of work. And it really requires the best and the brightest to be able to come up with this. Products. So it's not just the petrol that you buy at the gas stations. It's actually all kinds of chemicals. It's all kinds of lubricants that we have. So it's much more than just the fueling up the car. And we need to differentiate those products every single day to be ahead of the competition, but also to be more fuel efficient. And then finally, although a lot of it is about innovation, we do have an enormous amount of retail as well. Retail and selling and commercial roles in the operations where we recruit for as well. So our quest for talent, and I mentioned we have a global recruitment organization, but we recruit for the most difficult locations, and whether that is in the colds of Sakhalin or in the deep waters of the Gulf of Mexico, it is usually very either engineering challenging or remote locations where the environment is under pressure or the circumstances are very difficult politically. So it gives an extra dimension on how you recruit and who you recruit and how you actually get them into your organization. And we don't have a real sexy brand to say, come and work for us. Well, you get to design the next app. No, we'll say, come and work for us. You'll go find oil in the Siberian Russian Sea, but that will be good for the future. Yeah, so it's a very different proposition. So what we've tried in Shell is let's look at how we do external recruitment, and looking at what that we started this journey about in 2012. What is it that we want to do different, and some reasons for change. So the first one is we want to improve our brand. We want to change the perception of people that they have from off Shell and really differentiate it, because it's not for everyone. Yeah. Second one is improve the quality of hires. So the ones that have been in the session with Lou, it's really all about the quality of hire. Yeah. Then it's also about improving the candidate experience. Yeah, so from some of the feedback that we received from candidates, it was, yeah, it's Shell, a really nice company, but you actually interview us, we never get to tell why we want to work at Shell. So really looking at your process and how you conduct your interviews to really open it up also for the candidate. And that really starts with online applications and even before that, attracting candidates. It's really about building pipelines of passive candidates, because the best candidates actually have a job. They are the top talent. They are on that curve that Lou explained. So you really need to go actively out and reach out to these people and create your pipelines. And that's something we've been doing on a very large scale, actually. And then as of any project that you would do, you want to increase agility and cost effectiveness. Yeah? So although our recruitment quality initiative wasn't about cost, in the end, you want to get some benefit on the cost perspective as well. And then finally, make sure that it's future-proof for Shell. Yeah, so things you change should last for a little bit longer than this is just the next trend. Yeah. So what have we done? And we will talk a little bit about a broader journey, but I will talk about driving recruitment excellence. So basically, the Recruitment Quality Initiative program that I've led over the last 2 years. And then my colleague will really talk about the brand and what we're doing in that space. So Let me give you a quick snapshot of what we've done in driving recruitment excellence. So we've launched a program which actually consists of 6 projects. And as I started off, happy to say they're all implemented. Yeah. And the first one is about our brand and employee value proposition. And we'll have a deep dive with Anna later, so I won't go into that too much. The second one was about targeted universities. So we used to show up at, I think it was like 400 universities globally. We spent an enormous amount of money. And we decided to say, okay, let's limit the amount of universities where we actively attract candidates. It doesn't mean you cannot apply to Shell if you're from another university, but let's make sure we put our efforts where it needs to be. And we've also revamped our campus ambassador teams. So basically we have around 1,000 people from the business globally that help us recruit on campus. So it's not just the recruiters, it's real life business people, engineers, finance people, what have you, to help us recruit on campus. Then we refreshed all of our assessments. Yeah. So whether it's graduate hiring or more experienced hiring, we've changed the whole suite of assessments that we have within Shell, reflecting our leadership competencies, but also making sure that it's a more interactive assessment, so that the candidate also feels that they're not just assessed to do the job, but also for a longer term future in Shell with potential. The next one is around resource forecasting. So those of you who are in recruiting will probably agree with me that one of the biggest challenges is to have an accurate forecast of how many people do we actually need to recruit this year. And I would say this is a continuous effort. It will never stop. We will need to make sure that we're always very close to the business, but we have put in some reporting, we've put in some workforce planning that helps us actually budget and forecast a little bit better. But as I said, it's a continuous struggle. Embrace technology. And whether that is the technology like LinkedIn and channels that we use online, or it is about utilizing e-assessments in your assessment process, basically look at the whole technology suite that is out there in recruitment land and utilize that as much as possible when it's beneficial for your process. And then finally, our talent acquisition system. So we changed we call it talent acquisition system, you could call it an application tracking system, but we've changed that from a almost custom built tool to a more service as a software. So we use the Brass Ring, the IBM Brass Ring solution. But that really helped us. And once you do that, you can also build it in a way that you are compliant, you standardize your processes, you make sure that you get your right reporting out of it. So it really helps you to redesign your whole recruitment process when you implement something like that. So overall, an enormous program. And it took us about 2.5 years to implement it all. So I'm not saying it's an easy journey. But at least, the thing is, once you take a step, you probably need to go all in. Yeah. So with that, let me hand over to Anne Alonso, who will talk us through some of the employer branding.
Thank you. Thank you, Ed. Hello, everyone. I have to say that when LinkedIn said to us that they wanted us to present on employer brand, and we have done to be with in the InDemand ranking, I was very pleased, because you see the brands that they are there. I mean, we are with the Googles, the Apples, the Procters, the Unilevers. I mean, it's quite a big, ranking for an energy company, as we thought. So we thought, great, we could do this. And I thought as well, I mean, what we have done really to be there. And we have done a lot of things, but if I have to wrap up everything, I will say that it's a clear brand strategy with candidate-centric, and as well, I would say, the clever placement of interesting content. So that's a little bit of the summary. And we started from the basis. We started basically what the people thought about Shell, and we wanted to know what the people think about living at Shell. And we came and we realized that our situation was for the general public. 20% of the people, they basically reject working at Shell. We have negative working in the oil industry. We have negative perceptions, and we are not the most glamorous sector to work at. So that was the first thing. So 20% of our candidates, a little bit out, and we want to get the best, and we want to get to be perceived as innovative. The second one was 20% of the candidates, they didn't consider us as an industry. They didn't have consideration, they have really low interest in working with us. We have already 40%. And basically what happens as well is that in general, they didn't know too much about Shell. We were a little bit of a faceless company, and they wanted to work for companies that basically feel like very innovative, very inspired there, and they have this kind of meaningful approach. And we thought, but we have that, actually, but how we can to transform that. So you have been, I don't know, you have been in the L'Oreal session this morning. So basically, you thought that inspire people in the beauty industry is difficult, welcome to the oil industry. So that was a big realization. So we wanted to research, and we asked our candidates, and the words that they used to describe what they think that is working at Shell. And we were a little bit better, actually. They have work like staff commitments, like global, like smart people, big, and so on, which was okay, I will say, but I am sure that you ask the candidates of Google and Apple, maybe they talk another story. So we went and we said, but what our employees, they think about Shell? And here we were, this was by far, we found by far more energy, I will say, because we were described as innovative, passionate, human, optimistic, and creative. We thought, this is great, actually. So could we actually transmit this externally somehow and try to change the perceptions? So we thought, it's a hard thing to do, but we want to try how we can position ourselves externally. And we grabbed everything and we did three things. The first thing that we did is basically we took all the input and we created a global insight-driven employee value proposition. And basically it was, here is simplified, but we researched 400 employees and external candidates and people. And we came with four themes or dimensions. Two of them are really related with the culture of Shell. Together, we have a very collaborative culture and as well connected. We are a very global company, very open doors company that you have a problem, you can call anyone in Kuala Lumpur or in Washington and they can really talk to you. And we have another dimension that it was about development, discover and propel. That is discover if you are a young graduate and propel if you are an experienced professional. And we wanted to have another one about the relevance of the job that you do if you come to work into the industry company. Yeah, and not just the relevance of the industry, but as well that you take responsibility from the first day. Yeah? So we did that and it was something that talking about, we really walk through the company. So we find this finding, we went over, I would say, almost 15 locations across the globe. We took with management, HR, business, etc., to see if it resonates, and we were not overselling the company later to the candidates when they were coming. And so everything was happy with this. And we did the second thing, that is basically we look at our created materials, how we were representing Shell externally. And we realized that it was very conceptual, yeah? It was, we understood what it was, the energy challenge, the difficulty of lighting a building of flats, but the candidates, it didn't resonate so much with them, and our business, they didn't like it. They couldn't see the business there, actually. And so we thought, let's start talking about the employee value proposition through everything that we communicate, and let's do something that it was a risk because it's much more expensive, but let's put people into our advertising. So we start talking and showcasing employees, how we are. But When we did that, and it worked really well, and we have all our businesses happy because we could have people in upstream operations, in project, in retail, etc. But we thought that it was not enough because, I mean, still we wanted the people to know just not what we do, but who we are, yeah? And a little bit to have this emotional attachment that could really to make closer if they know the employees that we have. So but I would say, instead of me telling you, I would say, let me show to you what we did. So we start talking.
If you would have asked me 3.5 years ago what I would be doing, I would have never said oil and gas.
But instead of going opposite directions, they'll be parallel.
Oh, really?
Shell is looking for future leaders. I like this statement.
I am responsible for the development and blending of bespoke fuels and lubricants products that we provide to the Ferrari Formula One team.
This is the GTL4, meaning 4 centre stokes at 100 degrees C.
That's correct.
It gives me a wide range of opportunities to work in challenging projects and in stuff that really matters.
This is the flow line where our oil flows.
My role is to speak with geologists and the geophysicists that actually look at the Earth and tell us whether this could be an area of interest. And then on top of that, my role would be to discuss with governments the added value that Shell can bring to a country.
I'm Prashantani Sundran. I'm a subsea controls engineer.
I am Zhu Changlong. My job title is production technologist.
My name is Cara Tredget, and I am Shell's Ferrari technology manager.
My name is Mark van Rooyen, and I work as a senior commercial advisor in floating LNG.
My name is Mohamed Arriahi, and I'm a rotating equipment engineer.
My name is Anna Flanoy, and I am a drilling engineer. When I tell people what I do, they don't believe me, but it's fun, I love it.
So, I mean, we produced this video with volunteers, people that wanted to hear, and we cut it and we placed in our social channels, and it went really, really high, the highest engagement that we have in Shell. But we wanted as well to portrayed the branding in our print advertising, in more things, in a way that it was more inspirational, not just showing people, but showing people in environments that they were, but I mean in a more fun approach. And we were looking for the curious engineers. We were looking as well for the explorers for graduate. We were looking for basically the passionate people to join us in the adventure. So we changed a little bit the communication and trying to focus on the relevance of the attribute that make the differentiator of Shell, that is the people that work for us. And the people that work for us say us, I mean, we feel that we are ingenious, that we are innovative, that we are tenacious, that we are very respectful, and we want that to be. So that's how we are positioning right now the brand. But the third thing that we wanted to do in terms of the brand strategy, we wanted to reach the young audiences, and we wanted to involve them. How we can engage with the students, how we can make them to participate and to test Shell, I mean, a little bit of trial. And I am new in recruitment, actually. I have been this 2 years in recruitment. So when I joined, I thought, okay, I discovered 2 things, one bad and one good. The first thing is that my budgets, they were pretty limited. I don't know if this resonates with you, but the second thing is that being in recruitment, I could go to any place and I could say, hey, hey, do you want to talk about the future of the company, how we can recruit? And I could really try to approach and to get synergies with other businesses. So we did something, or we analyzed Shell, what we have, and we start being very creative with using the assets available, especially if it were not us, it were from other businesses. And so we realized in Shell that we have, for instance, we have a big division that does innovation. Probably you are familiar with the Game Changer. They do a lot of innovation. Another thing is that, as Ed mentioned, we have a big strategic team that does the scenario planning. People that is talking is working on alternative energies and people that is working on the stress nexus, that is basically to try to collaborate together with other companies in trying to resolve the energy, food, and water interchange. Yeah? So we have that. And as well, we have a lot of partnerships. I am sure that you are familiar with that. So we could, I thought, why I cannot get advantage and send my students to Formula One Grand Prix, et cetera. So can I do this? But we have more. We have hundreds, a lot of content available in the company that other businesses they were producing, and we were not getting advantage of that, so why with that? And the most important thing I would say is that we have a lot of keen employees that we can use and we can really involve. So what we did, and we thought, okay, we want to engage with young people, we want to involve them, so let's try to do a global competitions for a student, knowing that there are hundreds of competitions available there, but we are going to do a competition that builds, is around innovation, is around ideas, and we are going to ask game changers to do that for us, to run that and to give us the know-how. We are going to talk about the future and about the food, water, and energy nexus, and so the theme is going to be about ideas of how to progress in energy, food, and water, and we are to use our sponsorship, our relation with National Geographic, that is something that we were working with them, and we are going to use our employees to review the ideas and to mentor the students. So we created Ideas 360 that is basically that, actually, and we planning, we launched it last year, so this is the second season, and we wanted to do it in 5 countries, and we expecting to have a very limited reach, but it went global, really global, and we have ideas coming from 44 countries, and it was a nice surprise for us, actually. Let me show to you a little bit of what it is. Basically, this is a summary of what it is, and we researched what the students they feel about it, and we realized that actually, to our surprise, but it was a very nice surprise, we were changing the perceptions of Shell. They were feeling that Shell was not the image of that they have traditionally about that they demonstrate that we care about innovation, we care about the planet, and we care about the development of young people. And so that was a great thing to know. And as well, we inspire, I think, the overall Shell brand in terms, because the Shell brand is incorporating Ideas 360 into, or generated through Ideas 360, a bigger project that is Make the Future, that we will launch soon. And it's around that as well, helping basically young students to really develop. So this is basically the three things that we did in our brand strategy. Now let me take you a little bit about the content or how we engage with our audience. And yes, one important thing that I will slide is that to share our audience, we have to have very interesting content, but the distribution that you do of that through the channels ecosystems is very important. And for instance, for us, we have Out of the visitors that we have at Shell website, around 50%, a little bit less, but between 40 and 50%, they come to the career sites. And they come through laptops, through tablets, through mobiles. I mean, and we have to be there. We have to be engaging content. It's our bread and butter, because all our applications, they do through the website. We introducing Shell Talent Community, that I think that Ed mentioned before, that it's a CRM system. It's a talent management system that is help us to create, basically to create relations with passive candidates, so with candidates that maybe we can call later. And we did as well through advertising and print, and we LinkedIn, I mean, and other channels. LinkedIn is a great channel for us, so it's working really well. And we did a lot of events and webinars, new technology, and a lot of things in D&I, in females, etc., which is working very well. And if I want to leave you with something, I mean, I think that as Perelman say, I mean, content is king, but distribution is the queen, and she wears the pants, basically. Very important to that. So, and just very quickly, because I don't want to bore you with our process, but basically we have a framework for how we distribute the content. And basically we have, we try to inspire, we try to basically, as I say to you, with Ideas 360, with the website, etc. We try as well to inform, because we have a lot of content from other businesses that we want to share. We want them to add. They want to send an application or register to Ideas 360 or do something. And we want them to belong. Once that they have taken the action, they want to start testing Shell or trying Shell. Yeah? And we do that with the Shell Talent Community. And this has been very successful for us, actually, is because we, for instance, with LinkedIn, we have, this year, we reached 1 million. Basically followers. Right now we have around 1,200,000. We are, as I say, number one in demand in energy, number 12 globally, and 85%, which is, I think that is, of our employees, they are already in LinkedIn. Yeah? And we are doing, actually, promotions to employees through LinkedIn. For instance, employee referral program, when I go to my profile, I see it there. And as well with the other social media channels, it's working very well for us. And what you will wonder, I mean, why you want to oil an energy company. So I think that we are doing something for the people to follow, actually, on this. And this is just to give you a little bit of a small shop of what is the content that interests. I mean, and it's basically a little bit of everything. It could be like the 1 million of LinkedIn to our big projects, but as well and especially about our employees. Yeah? So really, really good. And another thing that we have discovered is that others, they have been starting to tell the story, especially with Ideas 360. Ideas 360 have gotten, I mean, a really high engagement, 12%, 9%, 8% across social media. But we have seen that the students, that they participate or they register, they start basically distributing the story for us, which is quite an interesting one. And the final point that I want to make, actually, in my presentation, is that engagement has to be earned. And because people trust people more than brands, we want to give our employees a voice. And basically, what we have done is a big project that we have around the employees as an ambassador. And the employees are the representation of our brand. And basically, they are the ones that, especially in the candidate recruitment, they are the ones that they are personifying Shell. So better that they are well prepared and better that they are able to tell the story nice. So we have a process that we want to do. It's basically we want to make the employees to know basically about Shell, about the things that we do and about recruitment. We want them to like or to be proud of what we are doing. We want them to share, so through their social networks, through the conference, to every interaction, and we want them to participate. And we have few areas that they can participate. The obvious one is the employee referral program. I mean, another really huge project for us, or huge channel. I mean, we changed this as well with when Ed mentioned that we have put all our house in order, we really changed as well the employee referral program. We have the social ambassadors program that is basically employees sharing content of the company that they want to share, actually, and really amplifying the brand echo. Yeah? We have around 1,000 campus ambassadors program that is basically business people that they go to the universities and they engage with the students. Yeah? And we have around 5,000 interviewers and assessors that basically they interview, they talk about Shell and they assess the candidates. And the final thing, we have a lot of mentors and reviewers for Ideas 360. So this is a little bit of the overall, and I am going to handle now the final part of the presentation to Ed, that is going to talk about the results that probably you are interested.
Yes, thanks, Anna. And without a doubt, this was quite a journey, changing all of this, and also in the whole space, if for those of you who have been in recruitment for a long time, or talent acquisition, social media has completely changed everything. And I think that is what we're trying to show you. We have adapted our brand strategy, but also how we distribute content in that matter. But in the end, there's always the so what question. Yeah, so what? Do you actually hire more people? Does it help you? Do you have satisfied customers? Because if it doesn't, then it was a nice story, but it didn't really help you. So, looking at recruitment, and as I mentioned, we've gone on this journey some time ago, so we are able to say something about the outcome. And so let me run through it. I have 9 bullets, so bear with me. So definitely employer brands become stronger. We've created a different picture about Shell, and you see also the engagement's gone up. We've improved our candidate experience. We do candidate experience surveys. We score a relatively high score, so on a 5-point scale, we score 4 and above on those elements. So that's really encouraging. We have improved quality of hires. Yeah, so we see that especially the graduates that we hire in, that we have better conversion rates. The performance is actually increasing by changing the way we do our assessments, but also the targeting that we do on for specific schools. Proactive talent pool building, the building of proactive talent pools in our Shell talent community, I would say that is probably one of the major things that we've done. So basically creating our own little pool of candidates. So I heard LinkedIn talk about this morning, we want to connect 3 billion people. We say, okay, great to fish in that pool, but give us like 100,000 and we'll really engage with those folks because that is really... We don't believe so much in really cold calling. I think you need to convert somebody over time to really be the employer of choice. Engaged assessor and interviewer pool, and I didn't mention that, but when we changed all of our assessments, we also changed our assessor pool. And the big change there was we did nominate people. So you were nominated to be an assessor based on your performance, based on your potential, and your seniority. So it wasn't just people who like to help recruitment and make some hiring decisions, no. And it wasn't necessarily hiring managers either. It could be anybody in the organization as long as they fit certain criteria. Involved employees, I think we've shown some of the things we've done and how to engage your employees and how to motivate them to do things for you. There's a reduced average cycle time. That's gone down for us, especially for the more experienced hiring that we do across the globe. We hardly use any search agencies. I must say I'm really proud of that. 8 years ago when I came into Shell, that's all we did. Hardly use any. So sorry for those who are in the search agency business. Don't call us. And then bullet number 9, as I mentioned, when we introduced our IT platform for recruitment, we made it such that we could actually have excellent reporting out of it. So with one push of the button, I know how many process engineers in Malaysia at a job group 3 who were female did I hire in 2013. And that you need to build that in when you design your system, you need to make sure that your quality of information that you get into the system is there. Because if you want to do reporting, it needs to be reliant information. So it's 9 bullets, but I would say the bullet number 10 would be that we have very happy stakeholders. Actually, our business partners, we are much more of becoming much more a business partner than a service provider. because we give them insights, we give them a better service, it's much more professional. And I think that is, when I started out by saying, make sure that in your organization that is, recruitment is seen, or talent acquisition is seen as something as a real strategic importance. And I think that's a big differentiator. So before we close, and we'll have some time for a Q&A, some key takeaways. Focus on enhancing all the quality. Quality is key. Yeah. So whether that is in your process, or the way you advertise your organization, or the way you do your interviewing, everything should be based on quality. Because quantity, there's enough quantity out there. Yeah? 3 billion people that they're aspiring to connect with. Build a strong employee value proposition and make sure that it is actually true. Yeah. And then obviously your brand strategy. What is it that you want to tell about your organization? As Anna mentioned, create inspiring content, yeah, and distribute it through the right channels. Really target it. Make sure that the right people see your message. And then empower employees to share their story. I think within any organization, your own employees are your best advocates. They will do it for free, yeah, and they're actually better believed by their connections or peers in the industry. So, and the final one, and I think that is really important because the journey actually never ends, is make sure you monitor your progress and keep evolving. So if you see how quickly, I was at the LinkedIn conference 4 years ago, I was mentioning that it was in a small hotel, and look at this now. So this is how quickly things can go, and I think as an organization, you need to grow with that, because otherwise you run behind. So monitor progress and keep evolving. So that was our journey. I hope you can take away some of those learnings, and we're happy to answer any of your questions.
Fabulous job, Ed and Anna. Thank you very much. Do you want to take the weight off? Have a seat.
Yeah, all right. Yeah, very good.
So I think you know the drill now. If you've got any questions, there are mics at the back. So if you can make your way to the back, and we've got time for like 3 or 4 questions if people want to ask.
Yeah, you go.
Okay, hello, I'm Brianna. I have a question, because I think it's a lot of work that you guys did, and I can't imagine that it's only something you did within recruitment. So how did you constantly involve the business in all your actions? So that you're not only supporting it from recruitment, also from the total Shell business?
Yeah, now let me try and answer that. So first of all, in Shell, we have a centralized recruitment function. So basically, we do all the recruitment for all of the businesses. And yet they play part in our selection process, but basically we design on how we do recruitment, and they will need to come to us. Basically, if a hiring manager has a job, they need to come to us, and we'll run them through the process. So that helps, because there's kind of you have to go through this hiring process. But along the way, and I think Anna mentioned the employee value proposition, we did test that. So it's not that you just go and design and, let's just do this and see how it works. You continuously go and feedback to the business. This is what we are trying to do. How does this resonate? And how can you influence that?
Thank you.
All right. Yeah, I think there's a process that you need to go to the back of the,
Hi, I'm a bit small for that, but okay, I think I can manage. So I have 2 questions, actually. Oh. The first is, how did you manage to keep your employee image after all these, issues with the drilling in the Arctic? Because there was a lot of, bad publicity on Shell. And the second, I would like to hear more about this. I have to take a picture because I can't. This social ambassador program. I mean, if there's any kind of economic reward to employees who did that, so it's a bit more of that.
You want to answer that question?
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
So, I mean, with the question about the Arctic, actually, I mean, is that, I mean, I think that Ed put it really, really clear. I mean, is that there is not easy oil, and basically is that we have to take those chances. I don't think that it has affected in the employer approach. I mean, and I think that when you come to the industry, you understand that, I mean, if I have to power your lights in the house, basically we have to get the oil, unfortunately, but we have to do quite, I would say, I mean, we explain why, what's the reason. The other question of the employee value proposition, so in the employee's engagement, is that, I mean, basically is every, we were doing through the recruitment quality initiative, few of these things. We have the targeted university, so we have already, we engaged the business to have campus ambassadors, to give us people that they were going to the universities. With the assessors, the same. We were asking for the business, so it was really into the business. Employee referral program, we have that before, but it was not performing at the level that we wanted. I mean, we want to reach around 40%. And now we are in the 30% of our recruiters coming through the employee referral program, but it's really successful. And it's not just that it's successful in bringing people, but it's successful in including people, because the employee that brings someone take care of that person. Yeah. So, and with the others, basically, the social ambassadors is quite new, actually, and we are helping with LinkedIn on that, and it's really working. We are really surprised of how is the good taking. We have a platform that distributes content and as well rewards the employees. Yeah? And you can do as well with, for instance, the students of Ideas 360, they are becoming social ambassadors for us as well, so they do the same system. And, I mean, so that is everything integrated now.
Yeah, but there's no reward, just to, for your, so there's no, we don't pay a reward for the social ambassadors.
No, it's more, I mean, yes, it's basically, is the reward of a basically well done, it's more internal, basically, it's gratification.
Yeah. Question for Ed. A moment ago you said that in case of given position has to be filled, they have to come to you and then you take over. So in an ideal world, that should also happen in my organization, but I'm often bypassed. So I'd like to know which kind of stick you use to avoid that. Thank you.
Yeah, so I mean, it's probably different in every organization. So how do you avoid certain things? So I'm not so sure how I can answer your question, how I can help you. I don't know your organization. Schlumberger. Ah, okay. Sure. Then we should talk offline. I can probably help you a little. Because otherwise it would be a too long of an answer, I think. All right. Okay. Thank you. Any other
questions? Which reminds me, I forgot to tell you the rules. Can you actually, when you ask the question, can you say your name and where you're from, please?
Yep. My name is Filippo Cellini. I work in Pfizer. I have a question about localization or local specifics. I assume you have a globalized, a centralized model in place in Shell. So how did you cope, how did you manage with all these millions of local requirement, languages, laws that we have in Europe? Because I think one of the challenges, consistency, standardization, but then we need to face that in local markets, there is a lot to be, say, reflected in our models.
Yeah. No, it's a very good question. I do have to say, within Shell, the corporate language is English. And if you want to apply to Shell, you have to apply in English. So there are certain standards that we do. Now, there's a couple of exceptions. So in China, for instance, we allow Chinese applications because otherwise you don't get to the talent. But on average, we try and standardize as much as possible. But in terms of branding, I think we try and use as many cultures and diversity in our expressions as possible. So at least on the attraction side, we show that we are a very diverse and global organization. But in terms of, let's say, languages, we tend to stick with English, because that's our corporate language. But obviously, all the other legal requirements that certain questions that you can or cannot ask in an application process, obviously that we will adhere to. Yeah. Thank you.
I think we've got time for just one more.
Thank you. I'm Nor van Boven, I'm from SoundCloud. My question is, like, building talent communities is of course a very hot topic in recruitment land. But how in practice does that work? Because you are talking about numbers of hundreds of thousands. How do you stay engaged with them without it being a constant sales pitch of Shell?
Yeah, it's actually a very good question and a very recent question, I think. So when we launched this Shell Talent Community, we had a bit of a debate about, okay, should it be kind of an open for everybody or should we limit it? And we came kind of somewhere in the middle where we said, well, we will not advertise it broadly. We will only advertise it, you know, in the places where we think we can find the right talent, and not even externally. I think we didn't even advertise it. But we receive about 5,000 signups per week, I think it is. Yeah. So it goes way too fast. So we're actually now in the middle of changing strategy to say no, it's going to be by invite only. So it's our recruiters or our sourcers that will put candidates into that talent community rather than people signing up. But it's a very relevant question.
Yeah,
we didn't expect that level of activity.
Yeah, I mean, from the marketing point of view, I mean, we have a big panel. I mean, I think that right now we have 400,000 people in the talent community that we use it to build our brand. So basically to send content and so on. But we are able to segmentate and go, so the wealth engineers, the commercial advisors, etc., and we are able to tailor the information that we want to say. But our aim is to have that kind of candidate intimacy that basically allow us to really create really this pools of talent that we make pass from passive to active. Like really exclusive wealth engineers room or IT professional room. And to do that, I mean, we can, having the overall mass approach doesn't work for us. I think that we have to be more exclusive.
Sorry, I know this is the last question, but this is my 1B question, it's a sub-question.
That's
question.
Just cheating.
I'm going to continue with it. I will attack you over drinks as well. But like, what kind of platforms do you use? Because you can have one-dimensional communications and you can send your awesome videos. Looks really, really cool. But or are you really creating a platform where you have interaction with that talent pool? Like, even if you segment data, I can imagine that it's still not easy to keep that ongoing. And if you have the answer, I would love to steal it. So,
yeah, I mean, right now is very simple. I mean, we are learning because I mean we are really recent. So what we do is we have the typical newsletter that we send information. We have as well a snapshot of advertising that we send, for instance, for the Women Day. I mean, we talk a lot about D&I and females in our company. Or we create webinars, you saw something before, and we invite the people in the talent community. But if we use as well as a recruitment tool. In basically, we look it and we search for talent on this one. What more we do? We go to conference and we invite the people to register. Right. If we go to oil conference or gas engineers, we ask them to register and we have that and we proactively manage the database. And if you go to our website, I mean, if you look, I mean, it's not so obvious, but if you are one of the disciplines that we don't have, I mean, you could find a link to join the Shell Talent community, and what happens is that you receive updates about your specific skill pool.
Cool, thanks. No other questions.
Okay, I think we're out of time. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you.